Luton Town kicked off the new season with a 2-1 victory over Oldham Athletic on a lovely sunny day at Kenilworth Road. The Latics took the lead there when Mark Bonner swung over a corner where it was met by Wilf Haining. 1-0 to Oldham. But the Hatters drew level with a corner of their own in the 19th minute. Steve Robinson picked out Steve Howard and the big striker headed the equaliser. That made it 1-1. Good delivery and a firm header by Howard. The home side now were playing with plenty of confidence. Foley and Coyne played a neat 1-2 from a throw-in. Howard was on the far post. The ball fell kindly for Underwood and he converted from close range. His first goal for the Hatters in his first full competitive game. Midway through the first half, Stephen O'Leary delivered a cross into the box which just eluded the diving Vine. However, the referee, Mr. Leek, decided that Swindon centre-half Sean O'Hanlon had given Vine a nudge along the way and he awarded Luton a penalty kick, despite the protests of the Swindon players. Kevin Nichols stepped forward to fire the ball past Evans and give the Hatters the lead. Luton doubled their lead when Steve Robinson whipped over a free kick, Curtis Davis jumped with Rory Fallon and the ball shot past Evans. The Swindon man appeared to get the final touch, but Davis took the congratulations. Sam Parkin managed to halve the deficit and get his side back into the game when he lifted the ball over Marlon Beresford. That made it 2-1. The Hatters re-established their two-goal advantage 6 minutes into the second half when another Davis cross picked out Coyne. He headed back across the goal and Howard powered the ball past a helpless Evans. Alan Reeves then headed past Marlon Beresford after 65 minutes from a Brian Howard corner to pull Swindon back to within one goal of the Hatters. Barnsley got off to the perfect start after only 76 seconds when left-back Tom Williams made space on the left to cross. It was flicked on by Anthony Kay and Michael Boulding got the wrong side of Sol Davis to score from a rebound. That dramatic start to the game continued as the Hatters hit back within 2 minutes. Kevin Foley crossed from the right. It was met by the informed Steve Howard, who climbed above the hands of Nicky Colgan to head home his third of the season and his eighth in 7 games for Luton. The Hatters then took the lead with a solo strike from Vine to open his account for the club after a big Beresford goal kick had been flicked on. He coolly created space for himself inside the area and calmly slotted the ball under the body of the advancing Colgan. Another goal was added by the head of Ahmet Berkovic. He planted the ball past Colgan from Steve Robinson's beautifully flighted free kick. In the 67th minute, Luton made it 4 with a moment of magic from Robinson, who intercepted a pass 25 yards from goal and burst through before confidently striking the ball into the bottom corner. A fine individual goal. Stephen McPhail pulled a goal back for the home side when he curled a free kick inside Beresford's post after Alan Nielsen had upended Daniel Nardiello. It was an exciting game all right, and in injury time, Boulding grabbed a consolation with his second of the game. But by then, the hard work had been done, and the Hatters saw out the remainder of the time to record their third consecutive win at the start of the new season, something they last achieved in 1981. Paul Underwood won possession for Luton near the left touchline, and the ball was worked to Rowan Vine, who switched play to Keith Keane on the right. He crossed for the head of Steve Howard, who placed the ball into the corner of the net beyond Arjen van Huijsden. It was the eighth consecutive game for the Hatters in which Howard had scored. perfect delivery and another very good finish from the Luton Town striker. Blackpool took the lead here. A free kick, John Murphy got on the end of it to win a header in the penalty area, and the ball fell nicely for Scott Taylor to fire past Marlon Beresford. 1-0 to Blackpool. But the ever dangerous Howard stepped in with a brave header where the boots were flying and converted Vine's close range shot to level matters shortly afterwards. And after a game of head tennis, Howard brought the ball down in the middle of the park and lifted a through ball into the path of Berkovic. He beat Jones to the ball on the edge of the area and, despite being under pressure from the covering defender, found the finish from 10 yards to turn the game on its head. Luton finally made the game safe in the 90th minute when Rowan Vine and Berkovic sprung the offside trap, and although Vine's initial shot was saved by Jones, Berkovic was the first to react to the loose ball and he coolly lifted it into the net, leaving the covering player on the line with no chance. With 10 minutes to go and time running out for Luton to maintain their 100% record, Sol Davis won the ball on the left-hand side and found Steve Robinson, who in turn slipped it into the path of Kevin Nichols. The skipper decided to go it alone, and that 25-yard shot past Moss inside the upright finally brought the breakthrough. It wouldn't be the first time in the season that Nichols was Luton's inspiration. The first real chance of note arrived in the 21st minute when Sheffield Wednesday struck the woodwork. A delicate pass from Marsden found Lee Peacock with his back to goal in the Hatters penalty area, and he hooked a powerful shot which struck the inside of Beresford's post and bounced to safety. 9 minutes from the end, Coyne cleared off the line to deny Wednesday, and Chris Brunt fired the rebound over the bar as the home side twice went close here. It proved to be the last chance of the game, which ended in a 0-0 draw. Luton made a good start to this energetic match when Rowan Vine picked out an unmarked Paul Underwood on the left of the area. He regained possession and struck the inside of the post. In the second half, he went one better to win the game for the Hatters. A loose ball bouncing around the Luton penalty area was thumped upfield by Chris Coyne, and Vine led the chase. He nipped in between the two defenders, bundled aside Alan O'Hare, which saw the defender grounded, but it wasn't a foul, and the Portsmouth low knee was left with the simple task of placing the ball beyond Muggleton to win the match. Persistence by Vine and a good finish in the process. Marlon Beresford cleared the ball upfield, where Steve Howard flicked it into the path of Steve Robinson. He unleashed an unstoppable shot from 20 yards out. 1-0 to Luton. No sooner had the game got underway again than they doubled their advantage, when Rowan Vine escaped both the offside flag and the last defender in pursuit of a Kevin Foley through ball before cutting in from the flank and coolly side-footing the ball between the legs of Spencer. 2-0. Ahmet Berkovic made it 3 when Howard created the opportunity for him to loop a header over the stranded Spencer. That made it 3-0 to Luton. Stockport were awarded a free kick 25 yards from goal, and Richard Lambert emphatically curled the ball into the net to score what turned out to be nothing more than a consolation for County. A moment of opportunist skill from Ahmet Berkovic created the first goal here for Rowan Vine. The Croatian spectacularly scissor-kicked the ball into the path of the Portsmouth lone man, catching the posh defence out, and the striker was left with the simple task of side-footing in. Peterborough hit back straight after the break, becoming only the second away team to score at Kenilworth Road this year after Woodhouse slid in to poke the ball past Dino Seremet from close range. Luton managed to restore their one goal advantage in their next attack. Robinson clipped a ball into the path of Vine, who held off the defender and pulled it square to the unmarked Paul Underwood. He took a touch before side-footing the ball goalwards, and although Sonner slid in there, he couldn't prevent the ball crossing the line. Tranmere were handed the initiative in the 28th minute after Ryan Taylor was played in down the right by Paul Hall and he was brought down inside the area by Curtis Davis. The referee immediately pointed to the spot, but there was a hold-up while the Rovers players discussed who was going to take the kick. Taylor, Rovers' regular penalty taker, had left the field because he had treatment, so it was Hume who stepped forward for Seremet to save his penalty. Unfortunately for Luton, the referee spotted his assistant had called for a retake, and this time, Taylor took on the responsibility, some 5 minutes after the initial foul, and technically, whilst he should still have been off the field because the ball was not back in play. Once again, Seremet saved the penalty, only for Taylor to net from the rebound. Thirteen minutes from the end, Luton drew level, when Tranmere failed to clear their lines after a spell of pressure, and Coyne, forward from a corner, was picked out by Kevin Nichols. He planted a powerful header past John Achterberg. Paul Underwood won a corner which Robinson planted on the head of Howard on the far post, and although Provett got a hand to the ball, he couldn't stop it crossing the line. 1-0 to Luton. 6 minutes into the second half, Luton doubled their advantage. Some neat work down the left allowed Sol Davis to tee up Vine, whose thumping shot was beaten away by Provett, but only as far as Berkovic, who tapped home from close range. Gary McSheffrey, on loan from Coventry, wasted no time adding his name to the score sheet after coming on as a substitute. He picked the ball up in his own half, his attempts to find a teammate failed when the ball struck a Hartlepool defender and it fell nicely into his path as he skipped his way through the defence before rolling the ball beyond Provett for the Hatters' third. When Huddersfield came to Kenilworth Road, the ball broke nicely to John Worthington in midfield and he slipped it behind Foley into the path of Junior Mendes. He promptly turned inside and curled the ball beyond Dino Seremet to give the visitors the lead with a clinical finish. 1-0 to Huddersfield. A Tony Carr's corner was then sliced into the Luton net by Sol Davis for an unfortunate own goal and leaving the Hatters in the very unfamiliar position of being two goals behind. But 11 minutes into the second half, Luton halved the deficit when Paul Underwood appeared on the right-hand side and curled a delightful effort beyond the outstretched hands of goalkeeper Gray and into the net via the upright. But Huddersfield held on to their lead to inflict Luton's first defeat in the league since the final day of the previous season. Walsall took the lead here in the 7th minute with the first chance of the game. Left-back Zigor Arinaldo whipped a deep ball to the far post where Darren Rack, who could have shot, in fact pulled the ball back to the edge of the area and into the path of his famous player-manager Paul Merson. He side-footed the ball home, despite the best efforts of two Luton defenders to get there first. Walsall doubled their advantage from a quick counter-attack with Rack again the provider. He found substitute Matty Fryatt, who took his time before rolling the ball across Dino Seremet and into the net to steal the points for Walsall. Hull City would prove one of Luton Town's promotion companions. And here, their winger Stuart Elliott picked the ball up in space on the left and whipped a cross-come shot right over Dino Seremet and into the net to give Hull the lead. It was his ninth of the season. 11 minutes after the goal, the Tigers doubled their advantage when they caught Luton on the back foot after an attack broke down. Paul Underwood tracked back to try and avert the danger, but a misunderstanding with Seremet meant that the header looped over the Slovenian and into the path of Delroy Facey, who converted the chance from a tight angle. That made it 2-0 to Hull, and then they got their third of the half. A long throw flicked on, and Elliott was again there, this time on the far post. Luton badly needed to get back on track here, and quickly they did so against Bradford. Steve Howard headed the ball into the path of Berkovic, and the Croatian sensation, with his back to goal, fired in his trademark scissor kick. That overhead strike from 10 yards out gave the home side the initiative, and Luton doubled their advantage in the 32nd minute with a flowing move. The ball was moved inside, Vine dummied it, and Steve Robinson hit a first-time ball back down the left to Underwood. He took the ball to the byline and drew Henderson off his line before finding Howard, who finished cleverly, letting the ball roll between his legs before flicking it home from close range. Luton were really in the mood for goals here, and it was three before half-time, when a quick throw-in from Robinson found Berkovic in acres of space in the middle of the park, and as the Bradford defenders stood off him, he had time to consider his options and selected Underwood, who rattled home a low drive across Henderson. That put Luton 3 goals to the good. The fourth arrived soon afterwards, when the ball broke to the feet of Berkovic after Henderson had kept out Howard's shot. The 30-year-old had the goal at his mercy, but he chose to walk the ball into the net past the defender to the delight of the home crowd, and it was Berkovic's 7th goal of the campaign. Lovely finish here by the Croatian. Wrexham were Town's next opponents. A lofted right-wing cross from Kevin Foley was met by a towering Steve Howard header back across the goal and into the path of Steve Robinson, who planted his header past Matt Baker in the Wrexham goal. Really good build-up by Luton and a very tidy finish from Robinson. Next, Ahmet Berkovic set up Sol Davis for his first professional goal. He came in on the blind side to score his first in 229 professional matches. Stephen O'Leary made it 3, Portsmouth loanee Rowan Vine picked the ball up on the edge of the area and side-footed it to O'Leary, who scored from close range. Foley, who skipped past the backtracking Armstrong on the right and clicked an inviting ball into the aerial path of Howard, made the 4th goal. Howard scored it with that powerful header, and that put Luton well in charge. Another typical goal from Steve Howard. Berkovic found himself in the right place at the right time to head home from practically on the line after Baker had got a hand to Paul Underwood's far post header. This made it 5-0 to Luton in the 62nd minute. Eleven minutes later, Hector Sam replaced Chris Llewellyn for Wrexham, and the striker netted a consolation goal for the visitors with his first touch. Final score, 5-1. Both sides started this local derby full of purpose, early exchanges reserved for midfield. But in the 8th minute, a moment of class from Rowan Vine gave Luton the lead. The striker picked the ball up in plenty of space near the left-hand touchline and curled a 25-yard shot over David Martin. A fine goal. Luton doubled their advantage a minute before half-time. Berkovic's corner was headed back across goal by Coyne, and the in-form Howard turned the loose ball home. However, the two-goal lead only lasted as far as injury time, and MK Don's free kick and Small scored from close range. Berkovic and Foley now cleverly combined down the right-hand side before a cross to the far post found Howard, once again rising higher than anybody else, to net the third for the Hatters. Seven minutes before the end, Howard made it four, completing a well-deserved hat-trick in the process. He side-footed home a neat pass from Vine to ensure that over 3,000 Hatters fans had an enjoyable journey back down the M1. Luton made the breakthrough on the hour mark against Doncaster at Kenilworth Road. Kevin Nichols casually lifted a 20-yard free kick over the wall and beyond the reach of Warrington, before setting off on a run to the Hatters bench to celebrate. It was a typical goal from the Luton captain, beautifully placed wide of the keeper. With 9 minutes to go, Rovers pulled level. A good ball from Tim Ryan unlocked Luton's defence. Ricky Ravenhill squared the ball and it found its way through to Neil Roberts, who turned to make room for himself before shooting past Beresford. 1-1. Luton nearly won it when Curtis Davis came close to his first ever goal when he rattled the crossbar with a thumping shot. The rebound fell to Holmes, who hit a powerful volley goalwards, only for Dave Morley to make the block and preserve a point for his side. At Griffin Park, Dion Burton made the most of a 41st-minute chance for Brentford, dropping his shoulder to make room for himself inside the box and then unleashing a low drive across Beresford to give the Bees the advantage. It was a game Luton were never destined to win. The home side doubled their lead in the second half when a cross from O'Connor was turned in by Ben May from close range. Brentford 2, Luton 0. Against Port Vale at Kenilworth Road, Luton absolutely dominated proceedings. Stephen O'Leary went the closest for the Hatters when his volley came back off the bar, and then he watched as Ahmet Berkovic agonisingly headed the rebound over. For a long time it looked as though Luton would not make the breakthrough, but 6 minutes from the end, Berkovic rewarded the patience of the home crowd when he turned Foley's cross in with a scissor kick to win the game for Luton. A typical finish from the Croatian. Now the action moves to Ashton Gate, where the town were awarded a free kick in the 33rd minute and Underwood drilled the ball towards Chris Coyne on the far post. Vine recovered possession for the Hatters and slipped the ball back to Underwood, who looped the ball up to the far post. Coyne was still forward for the set piece and his header past Phillips gave Luton the lead. The home side drew level when a harmless looking up and under from Brian Tinian fell to Leroy Leiter, who netted with an overhead kick to score his first goal in 7 matches and equalise for City. With just over a minute of normal time to go, Underwood returned a Foley cross that Phillips had initially punched clear. The ball back into the box was low and hard, and at the near post, Enoch Shawonmi got in front of Matt Hill to score a late winner for Luton. No wonder he went behind the goal to take the congratulations and celebrate with over 800 travelling Luton supporters. This was an important win for Town. With 3 minutes to go of this Boxing Day encounter, Peter Holmes hammered a half volley from the edge of the area, which was heading off target, until Enoch Shawunmi intervened to head the ball back across the goal and past Carl Muddleton to secure the victory for the Hatters and take them past the 50-point mark. Colchester took the lead here in the 34th minute with a bizarre goal. Craig Fagan crossed towards Richard Garcia. Steve Robinson appeared to get there ahead of the United winger, but in doing so got a touch himself to turn the ball past Marlon Beresford for an own goal. But Colchester's lead was to last only 2 minutes. They were unable to clear the ball after a spell of Luton pressure, and Rowan Vine was on hand to turn the loose ball in from close range after a drive from Peter Holmes had been deflected into his path. Three minutes into the second half, Kevin Nichols single-handedly took the game to Colchester, and his determination was rewarded with a goal. Although he could only watch as his shot after a gritty run was kept out by Davison, Vine was again on hand in the right place to turn the rebound home from close range. At 2-1, Luton must have thought they had the game won, but Colchester were determined not to be beaten, and they equalised when Greg Holford got in behind Coyne and got up between the Australian defender and Beresford to loop that header into the net for the equalising goal. An early mistake by Luton against Sheffield Wednesday. Curtis Davis let the ball bounce, expecting Beresford to come and claim, but Kenwyn Jones nipped in, and as Davis headed the ball in the air, Jones stuck his leg out to divert it goalwards and into the net to give Sheffield Wednesday an early lead. Luton hit back at the start of the second half. Steve Robinson thumped a volley against the underside of the bar. The rebound sat up kindly for Berkovic, and he headed across to Steve Howard, who levelled matters on this his 150th league appearance for the Town. A terrific shot from Robinson, unlucky for him that it came back off the bar, but there was Berkovic just nodding it across the goal, and Howard comes in on the far post, a final score of 1-1. Into the new year now, and at London Road Peterborough, the Luton Town skipper Kevin Nichols stepped up to take this free kick and curl in his sixth goal of the season, beating the dive of goalkeeper Mark Tyler. Free kicks and penalties were something of a Nichols speciality during this championship-winning season, and that was a perfect example. But Peterborough equalised in the 74th minute. Adam Newton lifted the ball in towards substitute Richard Logan, and he flicked on for Callum Willock to head home from 6 yards out and bring the score back to 1-1. It got worse for Luton 9 minutes later. Andy Legg's long throw, and there was Willock again to make it 2-1 to Peterborough. The advantage, though, was short-lived. Luton hit back from their next attack. The ball was crossed by Paul Underwood towards the far post for Steve Howard, who rose highest to head the Hatters level and stave off the threat of their first defeat since the start of December. Good delivery by Underwood, and again an unerring finish by Howard to save a point for Luton. Chris Coyne pocketed his third goal of the season on 28 minutes here to open the scoring. The Hatters defender was in the right place at the right time after earlier attempts had been scrambled away from Steve Robinson's corner. Eight minutes into the second half, Luton doubled their advantage thanks to Steve Howard's 18th goal of the season. Ahmet Berkovic was allowed acres of space down the right flank to deliver a perfect ball across the face of goal. Watch the way Howard muscles his way past two Stockport defenders to pounce from close range. Luton's third arrived in the 74th minute, eventually from a penalty. Watch as this attack builds up, Ahmet Berkovic come into the play and try a nice chip and chase on the edge of the area. But look at that handball there by Jim Goodwin. It was spotted by the referee, and despite the Stockport protests, he pointed to the penalty spot. That was the signal for the one and only Kevin Nichols to step forward again, and he doesn't miss from here. A quick turn, and the goalkeeper can't get near it. Another goal for Nichols, another win for Luton. In a tight match at Layer Road, goalkeeper Marlon Beresford ensured a share of the spoils for the Hatters with a great save to deny Kevin Watson after the midfielder burst through in the last minute of normal time. It was the second draw between the two sides this season. When Tranmere Rovers came to Kenilworth Road, they took the lead in 4 minutes thanks to Eugene Dardy's bravery in the box, tucking the ball past Marlon Beresford in the Hatters' goal. It was a cushioned header from Hume which had enabled Dardy to get through. That was 1-0 to Tranmere, but Luton was soon level. Following the breakup of this Tranmere attack, a deep ball down the line from Kevin Foley found Steve Howard, who used his strength to shrug off Ian Goodison's initial challenge. But as the Luton striker ventured into the area, the referee awarded the town a penalty after he was felled in the box. Tranmere protested, but to no avail. And you know what's coming next. Another first-class penalty from Kevin Nichols, even though Achterberg dived the correct way. Luton's championship challenge really building up now. Firm strike again by Nichols. Even though the points were shared. Away to Huddersfield Town, Luton snatched the lead on 33 minutes through Berkovic. He was at full stretch as he guided home Kevin Foley's cross from the right-hand flank at close range. It was Berkovic's 11th goal of the season. But the home side came back strongly to rescue a point. Luke Beckett scored in the last of 4 minutes of injury time, lobbing Marlon Beresford to make the final score 1-1. Well, this top-of-the-table clash between two clubs who eventually went up wasn't settled until really late in the game. Ahmet Berkovic's header was a reward for Luton's hard work. As you'll see, he bravely got his head to Steve Robinson's swinging cross to leave goalkeeper Myhill with no chance. The celebrations almost lifted the roof off Kenilworth Road. Good delivery by Robinson and a fine header from Berkovic. The next stop in Luton's promotion campaign was Hartlepool, where they broke the deadlock on 20 minutes through centre-half Chris Coyne. The Hatters defender picked up the ball just inside the Hartlepool half, running through to the edge of the area before unleashing an unstoppable low drive past Konstantopoulos. 1-0 to Luton. And a good goal by Coyne. The Hatters extended their lead when Enoch Shawunmi drilled home a low shot after collecting Coyne's free kick. That made it 2-0. The goal infuriated the Hartlepool players, who surrounded the referee, claiming that Chris Westwood was in need of treatment and waiting for the physio to come onto the pitch. But they reduced the lead with an unfortunate own goal from Sol Davis on 62 minutes. As Luton tried to scramble the ball to safety, his header went goalwards and Beresford was unable to stop it from creeping in, despite Curtis Davis on the line. Luton restored their two-goal advantage 2 minutes later through Kevin Foley. after Vine had picked him out with a wonderful pass, the Hatters youngster shot past Konstantopoulos after a good run. Luton seemed well in charge here, but Hartlepool gave them some nervy moments at the end when Robson grabbed a late goal. But Luton held on to extend their lead at the top of League One. Luton made it 9 points in the space of 7 days thanks to a first-half strike from Rowan Vine, which sealed all 3 points against Bradford City at Valley Parade. The on-loan Portsmouth striker found the target as he drilled a shot in off the inside of the post. It was the only goal of the game. Vine was very much involved again when Walsall came to Kenilworth Road. It was his shot which flashed across the face of the goal, as Luton found it quite difficult to break down the Walsall defence. Close thing there. In the end, Luton broke through thanks to yet another penalty. Chris Coyne was sent tumbling in the penalty area in this Luton attack, and the referee didn't hesitate when he pointed to the spot. You can already see Kevin Nichols walking forward to claim the ball. Long protest from Walsall, but all to no avail. And once again, the outcome, with Nichols on the spot, was the same as before. He sent the goalkeeper the wrong way and gave Luton a 1-0 win. This was an exciting game at Vale Park. Luton made the early breakthrough when Kevin Foley put the visitors into the lead on 6 minutes, firing a shot under Mark Goodlad's body following some neat play from Rowan Vine. But the home side drew level on 43 minutes when Hibbert picked up a short ball to pick his spot and catch Marlon Beresford off his line with that perfectly weighted chip. That made it 1-1. A mix-up in the Luton defence enabled Hibbert to grab his second of the game, this time beating Beresford with a perfectly placed shot after turning his man inside the penalty area. It was all Port Vale at this stage, and the Hatters were to go further behind 10 minutes from the end, Port Vale needing this win to try and beat off the threat of relegation. Curtis Davis makes a rash challenge here on Painter, and the referee instantly gave a penalty. There were a few complaints about the award, and although Beresford did save Matthew's kick, pushing it onto the post, the Port Vale substitute followed up to score from the rebound, and that meant Luton's 14-match unbeaten run was brought to an abrupt end at Vale Park. This was perhaps Luton's most impressive performance of the season. They broke the deadlock on 10 minutes thanks to some excellent work from Paul Underwood. The former Rushden captain was able to pick out Ahmet Berkovic from the left flank, and the Croatian nipped in to side-foot home his shot. Once again, Berkovic timing his arrival perfectly inside the penalty area. This was to be the start of a 5-star performance by the Hatters. It was a really good flowing move that led to their second goal shortly afterwards. But when the ball reached the penalty area, watch the challenge by Lewis Carey on Rowan Vine after 25 minutes, because the referee decided that this was a penalty. And that only means one thing, a yellow card for the offending player, and another chance for Kevin Nichols to show how lethal he is from the 12-yard mark, sending the goalkeeper the wrong way and making it 2-0 to Luton. Some strange celebrations there. It was all Luton now, and the third goal wasn't long in coming. Bristol City with their backs to the wall and Luton on the attack again. And watch here for a shot from Steve Howard from about 25 yards, because the Bristol City goalkeeper Phillips can't hold it. And who nips in? Yes, it's Sol Davis, scoring his second goal of the season and putting Luton 3-0 up. Good drive by Howard, but the goalkeeper wouldn't be too happy with his performance there. An easy one for Davis. Into the second half now, but the pattern of the game hadn't changed. Good work down the left from Rowan Vine. A ball drilled across the box, and it's Holmes here who tucks it away on the near post on 61 minutes to make it 4-0 to Luton. A nice tidy finish. Luton completed the scoring through Ahmet Berkovic. It's Steve Howard whose header hits the crossbar. Vine has a shot blocked on the goal line and Berkovic scores from close range. A comprehensive win this for Town, 5-0. There was an early boost for Luton against Swindon at Kenilworth Road when Ahmet Berkovic was sent sprawling in the penalty area under the challenge of Matthew Hayward. Fred Graham, the match referee, had no hesitation in pointing to the spot, despite strong protests from the Swindon defenders. Cue Kevin Nichols, here's the foul again. And the Luton captain was to step forward to score his sixth goal of the season from the penalty spot alone. Goalkeeper got down well, but once more, Nichols found the corner. He rushed off to celebrate his goal with the injured Chris Coyne in the executive boxes. And as you'll see, it didn't take long for Luton to double their advantage when Berkovic grabbed his 15th goal of the season thanks to some sloppy defending by Swindon. Davis's shot wasn't cleared by the defence, and the Croatian simply shot under Evans' body and into the net from close range. Luton, that stage, very much in charge. But Swindon got themselves back into the game in bizarre circumstances. Proctor found the net straight from a corner. The on-loan Swindon striker somehow caught the home defence napping, including a bewildered Beresford, to see the ball creep into the corner of the net. But Luton soon added another when Evans made a hash of Nichols' looping cross and Peter Holmes nipped in before the Swindon goalkeeper had the ball securely in his grasp to fire into the empty net. In the end, a comfortable win for Town. Away to Oldham Athletic now, and Kevin Foley's delightful cross from the right flank caused problems in the Oldham defence. The ball fell kindly into the path of midfielder Peter Holmes. He teed up Underwood, who lobbed that shot over a stranded Mildenhall and into the net to give Luton the lead. Oldham brought themselves back on level terms through Chris Killen on 39 minutes. He displayed great pace to run clear of Luton's defence, and after getting himself in the perfect position, fired past Beresford. Worse was to come for Luton. Chris Coyne could only watch as he saw his pass back to Beresford fall short, which enabled Luke Beckett to nip in. He rounded the Hatters' goalkeeper and squeezed a shot in from a tight angle to put Oldham ahead. But Luton finished strongly and were rewarded for their patient football. Steve Howard's towering header from Kevin Nichols' cross sealed a vital point for the visitors. Sky's cameras witnessed a rare defeat on home soil for the Hatters as Barnsley ran out worthy winners at Kenilworth Road. Their pressure paid off after 32 minutes. Shuka had the easiest job of prodding the ball home after Beresford could only parry Michael Tropper's close-range shot. Shuka was then credited with a second after a powerful 25-yard run, but his shot this time took a wicked deflection off Curtis Davis, which left Beresford stranded. 2-0 to Barnsley. The visitors went further ahead after 42 minutes when a slip by Davis allowed Chopra to steal in behind the Luton defence and push the ball past Beresford. Could it get any worse? 3-0 to Barnsley. Luton brought themselves back into the game on 67 minutes through Enoch Shawunmi's turn and shot, which beat Flinders and found the corner of the net. But that was the only bright spot of a disappointing afternoon for Luton. Down at Torquay, the home side made a good start to the game when Aaron Brown crossed from the right for Adebayo Akinfenwa to net from close range. An early shot for Luton here. But they forced their way back on level terms midway through the half when Kevin Nichols converted Paul Underwood's in-swinging corner for his 10th league goal of the season. And 9 minutes later, Luton edged in front when his fellow central midfielder Peter Holmes found the target. Kevin Foley crossed from the right for the former Sheffield Wednesday man to score his 3rd of the season in only 9 starts. Good cross by Foley and a decent finish by Holmes. That's how the score stood until half-time, although the second period was only 6 minutes old when Steve Howard popped up to extend Luton's lead. Goals goalkeeper Andy Marriott did well to keep out Paul Underwood's thumping drive, but Howard headed the loose ball in from 6 yards out. On the hour mark, Torquay were presented with the opportunity to pull a goal back from the penalty spot. Paul Underwood was adjudged to have handled in the area. This time it was Luton who protested, but the referee was insistent it was a penalty. However, Akinfenwa wasn't able to beat Marlon Beresford. Instead, he could only watch as the Hatters' number one tipped the ball around the post. Then Rowan Vine popped up for his first goal in just over a month. He fired home from 15 yards out after being set up by Ahmet Berkovic, and that completed the scoring. After that convincing win at Torquay, Luton entertained Blackpool at Kenilworth Road and broke the deadlock on 16 minutes through a trademark header from Steve Howard. He rose above a crowded penalty area to bury Peter Holmes' corner and score the only goal of the game to give Luton 3 more welcome points. It was a really good corner from Holmes and an even better header by Howard. Enoch Shawunmi was standing in the right place at the right time when he put the Hatters into the lead at Bournemouth with just 6 minutes to go. Kevin Nichols' corner wasn't cleared by the defence, and Shawunmi's goal earned Luton another one-goal win. Plenty of defenders around, but somehow he got in the middle of them. With promotion confirmed for the Hatters during the week after Brentford defeated Tranmere, Kenilworth Road enjoyed a real party atmosphere against MK Dons. An own goal by the former Luton man Ben Chorley put town ahead after Kevin Foley had whipped the ball in from the right. Many of the supporters were wearing boater hats to celebrate not just promotion, but the club's 120th anniversary. In the second half, Luton had plenty of chances to add to their lead. In this attack, Steve Howard went close with a header from a cross by Paul Underwood. And later, Underwood himself saw his goal-bound curling free kick punched away by goalkeeper Baker. Nevertheless, it was 3 more points for Town. Luton were crowned League One champions after they came from a goal behind to clinch a 2-1 victory over relegation-threatened Wrexham. But it was the home side who took the lead through Holt. With the Luton defence at a standstill, he climbed above Foley to bury a header from Carlos Edwards' right-wing cross. Wrexham in the lead. But early in the second half, Luton made their domination tell. After winning a corner, Kevin Nichols delivered the ball into the near post, which was headed home by Curtis Davis for the first senior goal of his career. It's one he'll always remember, and on the day, it made the score 1-1. But it was Davis's central defensive partner Chris Coyne who nodded Luton into the lead when he connected with Kevin Nicholls' free kick. The Australian defender rose above the Wrexham defence to power a header home, leaving Foster with no chance, and that secured the League One title in style for Luton. Celebration time now at Kenilworth Road. It didn't take long for the newly crowned champions to stamp their authority on this game. They broke the deadlock on 6 minutes. Paul Underwood's cross headed on by Howard and another goal for Ahmet Berkovic. Brentford pulled level when John Sulaco's cross from the left flank seemed to confuse the Luton defence. Sodgy was there to head home from just inside the area. That made it 1-1. And Brentford had more to offer still. After Kevin Nicholls' pass was intercepted, they went charging down the field and Michael Turner's surging run was neatly finished off by Dion Burton, side-footing a shot into the corner of the net. 2-1 to Brentford. But now, Luton's luck turned. Steve Robinson went down under a challenge from Turner inside the area after Steve Howard had flicked on Kevin Foley's cross. The referee had no hesitation and pointed to the spot. A scenario we'd seen so many times throughout the season. Once again, the home defence protested. Once again, Kevin Nicholls turned, and with the usual outcome. Luton were aiming here for a 100-point target in League One, and in a dramatic finish, they got the goal that kept them on course. From a corner, Brentford failed to clear their lines and Enoch Shawunmi was on hand to head home from close range. Another example of the work that Luton did on the training ground when it came to set pieces. And here, they added a fourth goal when Rowan Vine pulled the ball back for Robinson to pull the trigger and fire home an absolute beauty from 20 yards. With Luton already crowned as champions, that goal was really the icing on the cake, as scenes of jubilation were witnessed on the final whistle in front of a packed Kenilworth Road crowd. A beautiful goal by Robinson and a day for everybody to remember. Because when Brentford kicked off and the referee blew the final whistle, it was the cue for the Coca-Cola winner's podium to be erected on the pitch, and the players stepped forward one by one to collect their medals before captain Kevin Nicholls lifted the League One trophy. No wonder the crowd were in celebratory mood. Let's enjoy those scenes again now with a special mention for the town boss Mike Newell, whose appointment made this whole season possible. The last game of the season now, and it was only 43 seconds old when Doncaster made the breakthrough. James Coppinger's surging run and cross wasn't cleared by the Luton defence, and Guy was able to poke the ball home from close range to give the home side that early advantage. But Luton was soon back on level terms. Just after the half hour, in fact, a well-worked set piece finished off by Russell Perrett. The Luton defender guiding a header into the net after Kevin Nicholls' free kick was put into a dangerous area by a Howard header. And the town's top scorer will not have scored an easier one throughout his career than that on 36 minutes after a mistake from Ian Turner. There was no immediate danger as Turner received a back pass, but the goalkeeper saw his intended kick upfield strike Howard to give Luton the lead. It was Howard's 22nd goal of the season. Doncaster, though, were back on level terms in 50 minutes through another bizarre goal that saw Steve Robinson head the ball into his own net. Dino Seremet's kick upfield was blocked and Chris Coyne's clearance just struck Robinson. Luton were back in front just a minute later. Kevin Nicholls with a typical surging run towards goal, and then he unleashed an unstoppable 25-yard shot which found the corner of the net. A brilliant goal by the Luton captain, and so typical of him and his season. Luton's travelling fans, mind you, had barely finished celebrating that when Doncaster popped up at the other end to get back on level terms for the second time in the game. Luton defence wide open, and Guy scores his second goal of the match. The final whistle brought the curtain down on a remarkable season for Luton Town, which saw the Hatters set a club record of 98 league points, beating the previous record which was obtained in the 2001-2002 campaign. So as Luton look forward to life in the Championship, let's say congratulations to Mike Newell and his team for a really fantastic season.
Mike, considering the club's, or some of the club's, off-field problems during season 2003-2004, when we still finished a tremendously creditable 10th in League One, going forward, what were your hopes and realistic expectations at the start of season 2004-05?
Well, I always believed that if we could keep the players together the players that we had here and keep the nucleus together and just add a couple here and there, that we had a very good side and a strong squad and a squad capable of at least pushing for promotion and playoff places. I didn't want the players to get too carried away and excited, but I know that they believed it as well, having done so well through the administration and through the difficulties that we'd had the previous season. Yeah, you're always looking to strengthen your squad and add a few faces, a few new faces. What we believed is what we'd seen in the players that were already here. We believe that they were capable of more. And I'm thinking now of the Sol Davises, the Kevin Nichols, the Amit Berkoviches. We knew they had football ability and we just hadn't got it out of them for one reason or another. In the season we were in administration, Sol and Nico had had discipline problems, Berko had had other problems, and we hadn't got the full potential out of them. To be fair to Nico, he'd struggled a lot with a knee injury. And we believe that if we could get them playing to their full potential and we could bring in the likes of Beresford that we did, Rowan Vine, Paul Underwood, we would have a squad capable, as I said, of competing for the playoff places. We didn't obviously think it was going to go as well as it did, or start off as well as it did, but we always knew that there was a good spirit down there in that dressing room. Without trying to patronise anybody, I mean, the football club is all about supporters. Without supporters, there would be no football club. Certainly here, after the last couple of years, there wouldn't have been. But anybody's football club is all about supporters, and that's why they're 100 years old. That's why clubs survive for 100 and odd years old, because it means so much to them. It's passed down through generations and generations. And personally, I mean, I'm grateful to the supporters because of the chance they give me when I come in under the circumstances. They were patient, and they allowed me a little bit of time. But to have the numbers travelling, particularly away from home, to the likes of Sheffield Wednesday. And the grounds that I can remember, Bristol, Wickham in the Cup last season. When you run out and the behind one goal is full, and that was the case on a number of occasions, no matter what ground it was or how big the ground was, the away support was full, and that makes a massive difference to players.
They've almost become the 12th player, can't they?
Well, they do, and players look forward to playing away from home as well, because they have that little bit of freedom. When I think of the Sheffield Wednesdays and those grounds that you go to, the so-called big clubs, they're on a level with us, make no bones about it. Whatever league you play in, those clubs are on a level with you. And if you have an away support that's full behind one goal, it just makes a massive difference to the players. And it just gets that little bit more out of them. I think the adrenaline flows when they go out to warm up and they see the support, and throughout the game, when they do play well, away supporters are generally more vocal than they are at home. I don't know why that is, but they just are. And I mean, I'm just pleased that they had a season travelling up and down the country last year, seeing us win games. Well, I think to win the first six was astonishing, really. I mean, because whatever league you're in, and I don't mean just in this country, I mean any country, any league whatsoever, to win your first six games is a phenomenal feat. And although they weren't getting carried away, I think they then sensed that we might have something down there, and the stuff that we were telling them about how good they were and all the rest of it, they were beginning to believe it. And because no matter how good you tell them they are and how much belief you have in them, they have to prove it to themselves before they start believing it. And I think after that first six games, and then we went 12 unbeaten, I think there was that little air of confidence creeping in, without them being arrogant or whatever, there was that air of confidence creeping into the play and to everything that they did. And we knew then at that stage that we had a real chance of promotion. You can never please everybody, you know. There will always be the moaners and the groaners, and I'll still get letters and whatever when we've lost games or when things have not gone well. There will always be the pessimists, but in general, the majority of supporters will support their club through thick and thin. And we're just glad, as I said, that we could reward them with the season that we produced last season.
We were neck and neck with Hull for just about all of the season. But of course, following their defeat here at Kenilworth Road in February by that tremendous last-minute goal, did you then perhaps begin to feel that not just promotion, but possibly the league title was realistically in sight?
Well, if I'm honest, totally honest, I believed it well before that. I never said it, and I certainly wouldn't have said it publicly. But in the dressing room, I was beginning to tell them around Christmas time that they could, that I knew they wanted to win the league, and that's what we all wanted. But we never said that outside of the dressing room or publicly. The Christmas games, when we were without players such as Rowan Vine, Curtis Davis at Chesterfield, Howie for three games as well, I remember Bristol City, and we went and won them, and I thought, we can win this league, not promotion, we can win this league now. So it was well before the whole game. The whole game was a fantastic atmosphere, and after the Berko goal, the last 5 minutes, it was as good an atmosphere as I've ever known at Kenilworth Road. I just wish it would have lasted for another 20 minutes. But we certainly knew then that we had a real chance of winning the league. But as I said, if I'm honest, we had a belief amongst ourselves well before that.
And Mike, just finally, with promotion into the Championship League as champions of League One, expectations from everybody, and probably most importantly yourself, are extremely high. Do you have a message of intention for next season that perhaps you could give us?
Well, I don't want to raise anybody's hopes, but I don't similarly want to put a negative face on it and say that staying in the league would be a success. Ambition to me is to keep progressing the club and to keep moving the club up the league. And there's no telling what these players can achieve, because it's not like they sneaked into the league by promotion via the playoffs or whatever. They absolutely stormed into the Championship. And they are of an age, of a good age, where they can keep progressing and keep learning. And I believe that we can surprise a few people. I really believe that we could surprise a few people this season. And at the end of the day, they're just teams that you're playing against. It's 11 against 11, and we believe that we've got a good set of players, a great spirit, and that they will keep getting better and better.
Chairman, you officially took over the club in May 2004 and therefore were very active with Mike Newell and the football management in the planning for the new season. But could you, at the start of this new milestone in the life of Luton Town, have ever envisaged such a magnificent achievement was in our grasp?
Peter, it'd be nice to say yes, I knew it was going to happen, but of course no. I always felt that we would do very well. When we took over the club, there was 9 players were up for sale. We had made a decision to continue with Mike Newell as the manager. I know Mike many years, and Brian Steen and Mick Harford, it was at the time, who played his part before he moved on. But certainly when I signed the players that the manager recommended that we needed to tie up, there was a good feel factor even then that they were really wanted to do something better. So I thought we would surprise a few people, and the hope would we might be knocking on the playoff, but to actually go up as champions and in the style we did says everything about the players, and it made me very, very proud and pleased for the supporters and everyone connected with the club.
As the chairman, you attended all 46 home and away matches, and during this momentous season, of course, you travelled many thousands of miles. What were the specific highlights that you remember, and was there any special memories that you have of the season?
Well, I was always very excited watching our players. We got a and Michael's done a magnificent job. We've got a really excellent dressing room, a magnificent squad of players, and even our youngsters. And so that was always in the back of mind. Enjoyed the way the football that we played, and I know Luton supporters do as well. So I suppose when I looked there, that the travelling support was absolutely extraordinary. Over 47,000 Luton supporters travelled to all the games, you know, over the course of the season, which was magnificent. We'd always stay with me. I think our celebrations of the last home game, when we were champions after the Wrexham match, will take some beating. The fans, to make people happy for that a short period of time, is something that makes the hair on the back of your neck tingle as well. And so that point, in terms of the footballing, I think Bournemouth was the telling point for me. Away at Bournemouth there, Dean Court, and losing Russell Perrott 15 minutes into the game, and then actually getting the result told you everything to what the team were trying to do and what the football management were doing. So
showed you the strength of commitment, didn't it, Chairman?
It was a moment that said that whilst we all dreamed that it might happen, for me at that point, I genuinely believed it would.
It's a pretty magic season, and with a lot of memories for you. But going forward, Chairman, and of course, I think for all of us, this is the fascination of football, because there's always new challenges and there's always wonderful opportunities in front of everybody. What are your personal thoughts and ambitions as we look forward into the exciting world of Coca-Cola Championship football?
Well, I must say the Football League have marketed the Championship very, very well. And in truth, it's the league at our point of our history to be in. And so it's a challenging league. I feel no different than I did last season in League One, that we may surprise people. And I hope that we're working hard with Michael to retain our team and get one or two other acquisitions in there to get the squad up to 28 to 29 players. And I think we've got something really to look forward to, and I'm pleased that the fans will actually be looking forward as much as I am, because it is exciting times. What Brian and our manager Michael has done and the team has been magnificent.
Wonderful opportunity, in other words, for everybody at the club and for everybody that supports it.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, it's a very rare situation to go up as champions. I mean, I know it happens regularly, but for a team, a collective team together, I mean, the last time it happened was in 82. And we went up then. And now, you know, we've gone up again as champions with such a margin, 98 points. It's an incredible feat. And I just think that we've got, you know, we've got a great team. I know we need to build on it, that's Michael's way. We've got great management, football management. And coming back to a club that I love anyway, I know we've got a great club and great supporters. So to be truthful, Peter, everything's great at the moment.
Bring me sunshine in your smile. Bring me laughter all the while. In this world where we live, there should be more happiness. So much joy you can give to each brand new bright tomorrow. Make me happy through the years. Never bring me any tears. Let your arms be as warm as the sun from up above. Bring me fun, bring me sunshine, bring me love. Bring me sunshine in your smile. Bring me laughter all the while. In this world where we live, there should be more happiness. So much joy you can give to each brand new bright tomorrow. Make me happy through through the years. Never bring me any tears. Let your arms be as warm as the sun from up above. Bring me fun, bring me sunshine, bring me love, sweet love. Bring me fun, bring me sunshine, bring me love.